Kia ora and hello everyone, it's Tristan here and thank you very much for tuning in to episode 2 of Wine Stories. This one is entitled A Game of Rhones. So this week, in this episode, we're going to be looking a little bit more closely at the region of the Rhone in France. It is important to know that this region actually has two parts that are quite different in the terms of the wines they produce. So you have the Northern Rhone and then you have the South. We're going to be looking a little bit more closely into the South. So with me here, I've got a few wines that we're going to try from the AOCs of the region. The first one is a generic Côte de Rhone. So this wine is going to come from a wide area. And then the final two, we have a Resto, and then we have a Vaquina. These AOCs are a little bit more specific and delineated. So we're going to look at these wines a little bit more closely, and then eventually, once we move through the whole entire region, we'll make our way up north. So the Rhone is quite an important region in the country of France, and in the terms of historical and cultural aspects. And the reason is... Well, let's start with the cultural aspects. So basically, many moons ago, a lot of countries in Europe, they weren't countries, they were just city-states. So there's a lot of separation. And even in France, you had the North and then you had the South. Two very different cultures because the people that immigrated to those areas came from different parts of the world. And so the Rhone is super important because it was literally the meeting point and the crossroads at which those two cultures basically combined and became one eventually. In this example, I'm going to use the cuisine of the region. So in the North, it is very common that, they have a very dairy, heavy diet. In the South, close to the Mediterranean, there's a lot of oil. And so, as a result, the Rhone was a region where these cultures combined, and now the region of the Rhone, particularly Lyon, is a very, very, very sort of highly accredited gastronomical area in the country. So, moving on to the historical aspects. Again, many moons ago, I think in the 14th century, the Catholic Church and the Popes, they decided, we're gonna go to France and we're gonna take up residence in Avignon, which is a city in the southern part of Rome. And so they did that, and then as a result, there were about seven popes, French popes to be exact, that served in the name of God in that part of France, Avignon. So they built a castle, which they actually called Chateau Neuf de Pape, which is French for the new castle of the Pope. And this led on to them beginning to make wine there. And then eventually Chateau Neuf de Pape became a very, very highly sought after wine. And also come the 1900s, so around about 1933, Chateau Neuf de Pape was actually one of the first regions in the country to basically be awarded an AOC title. Okay, so now it's my favorite time. My favorite part of all my video shoots is tasting the wine. So the first wine we're going to try is it's from one of my favorite producers, Domaine de la Mordelais. These folks are a certified organic biodynamic producer, which is great. If you remember from the first episode of Wine Stories, we actually tasted their rosé and it was some A-grade juice. Very good stuff. But I haven't tried this yet, so I don't really know what to make of it, but I'm sure it will be good. Anyway, so this is a generic Côte de Rhone. And so basically, another thing that we need to go over is about 95% of all wine under the AOC Côte de Rhone comes from the southern part of the region. And so, as opposed to the other wines we're going to try that are from a more specific delineated area, these grapes can really come from anywhere around the regions. So this is why it makes it a more generic wine. It's not as specific. But, as I've said in the past, it does not make it a bad wine. So, Côte de Rhone from Domaine de la Mordelais. In terms of the grapes involved in this wine, most of these Côte de Rhone blends are Grenache, predominantly, Syrah and Mourvèdre. Sometimes, depending on the producer, they might swap the Mourvèdre out for Carignan or Sansol, or sometimes, depending on how many grapes they've got growing in the vineyard, they might decide to put little percentages of lesser known varietals in as well. And there is also some white varietals that are permitted for use in these types of wines. So let's give this a test. Right, so these generic Côte de Rhone wines, they are made with the intention of drinking young. Like you can put them away for a little while, but you're best to drink them young. They are made to drink now. And this is a 2015 and it's now 2018, so yeah, I mean, we should probably drink this now, so let's give it a smell. So these types of wines, they're very popular in my country of New Zealand, because the general person in New Zealand likes things that are fruit forward. We like fruit, and these wines are very fruitful. So straight away, on the nose, I'm getting a lot of plum, blackberry, blueberry, little hints of boysenberry, but yeah, definite kind of lavenderish aroma, little hints of vanilla, and yeah, obviously some spice, and that's the Syrah really coming through. But yeah, these wines are generally very fruitful and they're just very palatable and not offensive and just very, yeah, quite frankly, easy to drink, which is why I think they're very popular. Okay, so let's give this a sip. So, yeah, firm tannins, mid acidity, urine balance, good. Yeah, medium body wine, on the palate, yeah, definite kind of blackberry, blueberry, but plum, but very ripe, and then getting that lavender, sort of sweet spice, sort of hints of vanilla. But as I said before, these are very, very fruitful wines. Like, they're made to drink now, they're usually, yeah, very easy to drink, and this one is quite pleasant. But I'm also getting this kind of resinous rosemary twig aftertaste, and Domaine de la Mordelais, 2015 Côte de Rhone. This is an acceptable wine. Like, I'm really liking this. It's dry, it's very fruit forward, borderline ripe fruit, but yeah, absolutely delicious. It has structure. All of those structural components are intact. So no, this is a very good wine, and I, for the price, it's yeah, for the price, it's very, very good. So if you are interested in buying this, you can get it from www.winedirect.co.nz, and the retail price is about $21.99. And yeah, for the price, it's exceptional. It's a very good wine. Like, I highly recommend it. Yeah, great. Okay, so the next wine we're going to try. So before we try to Côte de Rhone, so generic Côte de Rhone, now we're gonna kind of zoom in on a more delineated area. And this is from an appellation by the name of Resto. And this is from a producer called Domaine Grand Nicolet. And this vine, this wine is from Old Vines. And it says on the bottle in French, Vieille Vine, which means Old Vines. And this is a blend, as I said earlier, most of these Southern Rhone wines are blends of Grenache, Syrah, and Mourvèdre. However, when you get to the more sort of specific AOCs like Jalisto, they're going to be a bit more fickle about what grapes you can use in the wine and what percentages you can use as well. So this one, it even says on the back, it's Grenache, Syrah, and Mourvèdre. And so I'm going to pour myself a glass of this and we're going to taste through it and I'll just tell you what I think. We have Domaine Grand Nicolet Jalisto, Villervine, Old Vines, 2015. Okay, so on the nose, a lot of ripe berry fruit, so I'm getting plum, some blackberry, boysenberry, ripe strawberry. Yeah, it's very, very, very ripe. There's even hints of like some gamey barbecue, like smoked bacon. Yep, that is actually a thing you can get on wine, smoked bacon. And then there's also, yeah, that little hint of pepper, black pepper, and a little bit of spice. So let's give this a little sip. Pretty sticky tannins. It's not a bad thing. You just need to match that with a food item that's rather sticky. But no, they're not invasive at all. It's got a very lean, well, a little bit more acidity than the last wine we tried. Yeah, but I definitely put this on the more medium to full bodied wine. On the palate, plum, blackberry, ripe strawberry, little hints of blueberry. But on the aftertaste and the finish, there's a lot of like licorice lavender, leathery notes on the mouthfeel, little hints of vanilla. Yeah, this is a very, compared to the last one, this is a very, very serious wine. And it could do with a few more years in the cellar if you have one or if you have a wine fridge. And I definitely think this would express itself in a different way within a couple of years. It's definitely drinking well now. But yeah, as I said, more serious wine, a little bit more full body than the last one. Definitely in the alcohol area, like, yeah, the first thing, I should have said this when I tasted it, was, yeah, the alcohol was the first thing that stuck out to me. But, yeah, not bad. There we have it, Domaine Grand Nicolet, Villavigne, Resto, Grenache, Syrah, Mourvèdre. Again, and I'm not just saying this, but yeah, very good wine, it's acceptable. If there's one thing that kind of stood out to me, it was the tannins were a little bit sticky, but it's no problem. I just have to find something to eat it with to balance that out. And as I did mention earlier, this could do with another year or two in the cellar. However, it is drinking well now, but if you're a bit sensitive to tannins, then I would recommend just letting it cellar for another year or two. Otherwise, you can decant it. But yes, the Mont Grand Nicolette, Alastair, Villevin. If you are interested in this wine, you can also buy this from www.winedirect.co.nz, and the retail price for this is $34.99 New Zealand dollars. Okay, so the third and final wine we are going to taste this evening is from a biodynamic producer called Montirieu, from the AOC of Vakira, which is a little bit further south than Rasto, which is where the wine we tried before is from. So yes, Vakira is a little bit further south than Rasto. And this is their brand, Garrigue. What is Garrigue? I'm going to elaborate more on this in a separate snippet at a later point in time, but it is a reference to the soil types that are quite common around this AOC area. So I've just gone and poured myself a glass of this wine. The producer is Montirieu. They're a biodynamic producer from the AOC of Vakira. This is a 2015 vintage, and this particular brand is called Garrigue. And in terms of the grapes that are used in this wine, if their wine comes from Vakira, they can use Grenache, Syrah, Mourvèdre, and Sansol. This wine, however, is only using Grenache and Syrah. So let's just give this a little smell and see what we get. So the first thing I'm getting is bramble, blackberry bramble. So if you don't know what I mean by bramble, this is basically a descriptor that just refers to the whole aroma of a berry bush. So basically what I mean is when I say blackberry bramble, I'm smelling the blackberries, but I'm also getting the smell of the thorns and the foliage on the bush slash shrub. So yep, we have a blackberry bramble, hints of plum, a little bit of blueberry. I'm getting notes of boysenberry, some definite black pepper there. That's the Syrah coming through. And in terms of the fruit ripeness, relatively ripe. Yeah, almost borderline sauciness, but not quite. But it is ripe. I wouldn't say it's as ripe as the last stow. Just a little bit more on the leaner side. Yeah, but I'm also getting quite pronounced aromas of lavender, licorice, and a little touch of vanilla. So let's give this a sip and just see where it takes us. Wow, so this wine has very big, round tannins, but it has a relatively high acidity as well, so not any one of those elements is overpowering the other, but straight away I'm like, yeah, this is a lot more leaner than the last wine we had. Yeah, as I said, it just has higher tannins, more acidity. I'm getting a lot of mineralic notes to it. In terms of fruit flavor, berry sauce, blueberry, boysenberry, blackberry. And on the finish, I'm getting this creamy vanilla, lavender, licorice. Which is also quite a common descriptor in wines from this part of France. Lavender, licorice. The great thing about the Rhone I love is because they are blending Grenache, Syrah, Mourvèdre, Sansol. The flavor possibilities are very endless, and there is just so much you can get from these wines, which is why I think they're so popular here. They've just got so much fruit character, but as I was saying, this wine, the Montirieu Vakira 2015 Garrigue, this is a little bit more on the leaner side than the last stow that we had, which was a bit more ripe. more full body. But delicious. Woo! So there we have it. We've just tried three wines from the Rhone, from the Southern Rhone Valley. As I mentioned at the very start of the episode, the Rhone comes in two parts. We have the north and the south. The wines we tried today were from the south. So the first one we had was from a biodynamic producer called Domaine de la Moderée, and that was their Côte de Rhone AOC and the 2016 vintage. In terms of what sort of wine this is and when you should drink it or buy it, these generic Côte de Rhone, generally they're made for consumption straight away. So you don't really want to put these away in the cellar or the wine fridge. You buy them because you want to drink them now. They're also very affordable, and if you like wines with a lot of fresh fruit presence, then that is the one for you. In terms of the price, they range anywhere from $17.99 New Zealand dollars all the way up to $29.99. Now the second wine we tasted was the Domaine Grand Nicolet 2015 vintage from Old Vines or Villavigne. The vines were 45 year old vines on average. And this was from the AOC of Rasto. So straight away, the first thing I noticed with this wine, it was a lot more ripe in the fruit department and had a lot more complexity of flavor, a longer finish, a lot more development in flavor going on in the bottle. Take the Domaine de la Moderée, Côte de Rhone, it was just fresh fruit and very fruit forward, which is not a bad thing. So basically, when you get to these AOC areas in the Southern Rhone, you will notice that their flavor complexity will just be a lot more vast. So these are the sort of wines for people that want their wine with a little bit more body, a bit more structure, and maybe the potential to put them away for a couple of years. But I, in my personal opinion, I wouldn't put a wine like this away for any more than 2 to 3 years. They do drink well young, but they also drink well when they have a couple of years to develop. But that really all comes down to just how you're storing them. But this wine, the Domaine Grand Nicolet Rasto AOC 2015, is for someone who just wants their wine with a lot more body. And yeah, as I said before, this was a more of a medium to full-bodied style. So if you like a full-bodied red, then this is the one for you. The last wine we had was the Montsérieux, who are a biodynamic producer, and this was their wine from the AOC of Vachira, branded garlic. And it was a 2015 vintage. Also, this was a blend of Grenache and Syrah. So how does this stack up to the Rasto? Well, to put it simply, if you want wine that's got a lot more body in terms of fruit and alcohol, and maybe some like hints of savory notes, then I would go for the Rasto. If you want a wine that has more body, if you want a wine that has slightly more of a leanness to it, so higher acidity, but still has like those ripe fruit flavors, not so much on the savory notes, then you should go for the Vachira. But strangely, when you drink them, not strangely, but when you drink them side by side, you will notice that, yes, these wines both come from the Rhone, but however, there are very, very subtle differences. So which wine will win the game of Rhones? Well, to be honest, I honestly don't think any of them will win the game of Rhones, because I like all of these wines each for different reasons, and none of them, from what I can tell from my experience and expertise, neither of these wines were faulty. There were varying differences in quality, and that all just comes down to viticultural and winemaking practices, and also the different micro/mesoclimates within the Southern Rhone region. But all very good quality wines. It all just comes down to what you prefer and what you're feeling like drinking at the time of purchasing a bottle of wine. So if I'm going to be honest, every wine here today wins the game of Rhones. However, on the next episode of Wine Stories, this one will be entitled Game of Rhones Part 2. We're going to be continuing to hang around in the Southern Rhone region, except we're going to be trying some of the white wines in the Southern Rhone. So please watch the space, and if you have any questions about any of the wines I've talked about through this episode, please private message me, and I would love nothing more than to answer your questions. So yeah, as I said, if you have any questions, please fire away, and I would be more than happy to answer them for you. But for now, I've got to go, and I will see you on the next episode of Wine Stories. Ciao!